Morning. Boy, it sure will be wonderful there.
Amen.
That's why we need to pay attention to the way we live here, so that we can enjoy the wonder that is there, that is promised, and that awaits us. Well, I'm glad that you're here this morning. Before we get into the lesson this morning, our focus this morning is going to be on Esther, but before we get into that, I would like to ask you to pray with me for a moment. There's some things that are going on in our world that I think need us to intercede and to bow before our Father. So let's pray together. Father, we bow before you this morning because we recognize who you are. We recognize that you are our Father. We recognize that you are the creator of the universe, and we exalt your name and your word. We extol your majesty and your glory, and we praise you as best as we know how. This morning, Father, I pray for my brother Jason, the preacher at Yorba Linda, who is struggling with some heart conditions and who's going through some testing, and just pray for him and his health, and that you would strengthen his body, that he might continue to strengthen your body. We pray for all of those people in Mexico who have been affected by this hurricane. We're so grateful, Father, that it was not as serious as we thought it might be. We're grateful that, at least as far as I've seen, that no one has perished in that storm. We know that there's a lot of rain and a lot of wind and a lot of damage, but we're grateful, Father, for the way life has been spared. And so we just pray for them as they recover from this storm. And Father, our hearts go out to the people in Oklahoma. Our minds try to wrap around a senseless act with so much damage, so much heartache. And Father, right now, I just want for them to be able to turn to you. Maybe there are people there who've never thought about you before, and this might cause them to turn to you. May they know your strength and your comfort. May they know your peace and your love. May they all pull together to endure this tragedy and to overcome all of the difficulties. Father, our hearts go out to them, and we just lift them up to you. May you be their blessing today. We pray all of this as we seek to learn from your word, that especially now you would bring clarity to the text, that you would bring meaning to our thoughts and purpose to our study, and transformation to our lives as we open up the word of life. Thank you, Father, for being our Father. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Well, we started this series called Jars of Clay, where really we're looking at ordinary people used in extraordinary ways, where God has done extraordinary things. And I think we need to remember that the focus, although we're focused on an individual and certain individuals within the text, we need to understand that the one to be praised in all of this is God, because the one who's really at work here is God himself. Paul would tell the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7, that we have this treasure in jars of clay so that God can be known, so that people would recognize that the power is with God and not with us. Oh, certainly there's an element of obedience on our part, and there's a thought of faithfulness on our part, and there's action involved on our part. But ultimately, God is the one who is at work. And God is the one, it's in His providence that is causing all of these things to happen for good. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, all things work together for good to those who love God, those who are called according to His purpose. And so we see that at work here in the book of Esther. And Esther is the woman that I really want to focus on this morning. She is a woman of God's courage. Esther is called upon to demonstrate tremendous courage at the risk of her own life. But one of the things that's fascinating is that Esther really teaches us to know when we're in the right place at the right time. You ever had that feeling where you thought, man, I was in the right place at the right time? And you know the joy that comes from that. And that's where God uses people the most, is when, not just when they're in the right place at the right time, but when they know that they're there. When they realize that, you know what? God can do something great here because I'm here. And He can use me in great ways to accomplish His purpose and to bring relief and deliverance for people. And really, this is Esther is a book about God's R&D department. You know, we talk about a company's R&D department, research and development. And companies invest millions of dollars into the research and development to always be creating and selling the latest gadget. I mean, you think of Apple computers. I mean, you think of all of these different industries, and research and development is the thrust of their company, of their mission. Well, R&D is the thrust of God's business. It's the thrust of God's mission. Although it's not research and development, it's relief and deliverance. And we see that here in the book of Esther. Turn with me to Esther chapter 4. I'm going to read just a short passage from Esther chapter 4. Beginning in verse 6. And I just want you to see what's going on with Esther during this time. Esther is the cousin of Mordecai. Esther's parents have died, and her cousin Mordecai has taken her in, raised her as his own daughter. And now she finds herself in the palace of the king, and she is the queen. Read the book of Esther and you'll get the history of that. But in chapter 4, beginning in verse 6, Mordecai is calling on Esther to do something that she really should not do. Mordecai also gave Hathach, a copy of the written decree issued in Susa for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther and explain to her and command her to go to the king to beg his favor and plead with him on behalf of her people. And Hathach went and told Esther what Mordecai had said. Then Esther spoke to Hathach and commanded him to go to Mordecai and say, all the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law: to be put to death, except the one to whom the king holds out the golden scepter so that he may live. But as for me, I've not been called. I've not been called to come in to the king in these 30 days. As they told Mordecai what Esther had said, then Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not think to yourself that in the king's palace you will escape any more than any of the other Jews. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place, but you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this. You see, who knows that you're in the right place at the right time for God's power to be displayed? Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, "Go, gather all the Jews to be found in Susa, and hold a fast on my behalf, and do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my young women will also fast as you do. Then I will go to the king, though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." Fascinating details about the book of Esther. There's some really fascinating trivia when you look at the book of Esther. It's interesting to note that in the book of Esther, there's no mention of God. I think it's a fascinating observation. Read through there. It's not a long book, and see if you can find God. He's not mentioned there. There's no reference to the Holy Land. This is probably at the beginning of a time when they're about ready to go back to the Holy Land, when Ezra and Nehemiah will return to Jerusalem. And Esther is kind of preceding that just slightly. But there's no mention of returning to the Holy Land. There's no definite religious teaching in the book of Esther. It's simply biographical. It's about this woman, and it's about her cousin Mordecai, and we'll see some other people who play a part in there. But there's no specific spiritual instruction in there. And what else is interesting, that in the rest of the Bible, there is no mention of Esther. There's no mention of Mordecai anywhere else in the Bible. It is this book alone where we learn of this fascinating woman, this fascinating man. And so we learn some things that are required of people when we know if we're in the right place at the right time. And the first thing that we need to be willing to do has really nothing to do with Esther, per se, but it has a lot to do with Vashti. How much time have you ever spent in looking at the woman Vashti? Because Vashti shows us that you have to have the courage. We're talking about a woman of courage in Esther, but Vashti is a woman of courage as well, because she has the courage to defy ungodly expectations. If you read chapter 1, it's all about how Vashti is deposed from being queen. In fact, she's divorced by her husband. Her husband has been throwing this party, and it's been going on for like 180 days. And then there's another banquet that is thrown that goes on for 7 days. And they've been doing a little drinking, you see. And the king has been bragging about his place among the people and his power and his prestige and all of his wealth. And he's been talking about all the stuff that he has. And so then the king, Ahasuerus or Xerxes, he calls Esther in. He calls Vashti in. And Vashti is probably the most beautiful woman in the world. I mean, if you put her in a beauty contest, oh, she wins hands down. And so he calls her in, and he wants to put her on display. He wants to show all the other men who have gathered around with him what he has in Vashti and how beautiful she is. And Vashti, she's a pagan Persian queen. She does not claim any alliance with God whatsoever. But she values modesty over her royal position. I think Vashti is a fascinating character in the book of Esther. The summons of Ahasuerus, the king, would have been a great insult to Vashti, because he was calling for her to display herself in a way that only her husband should see. And she refused. That takes great courage. I mean, she could have been killed for that disobedience. But this was a great insult to her. But you know what a little drinking will do. And that's what happens with the king. And so she refuses to display her lovely face and her figure before other onlooking men. She refuses to display herself in a way that only her husband should see. Does everybody see the application in that? Do we need to be clearer? We live in a day and age when more people need to hear this lesson from Vashti and have the courage to step up and defy social norms and customs and expectations, to choose honor and integrity over luxury and pleasure. It costs her marriage. And he issues the decree. And what's interesting is the decree is not just, it's not his decree. Ahasuerus is not really that strong of a king, because he calls upon the men who have gathered around, and the men who gathered around say, well, you know what? She ought to be put out, never to enter the king's presence ever again. You need to put her away. And so he says, I'll do that. But their whole motive in that is that if their wives see what Vashti has done in disobeying the king, then their wives will start disobeying them. And they certainly don't want that trouble at home. And so they say, put her away. And king says, you know what? All right, I think we'll do that. I think that's a good idea. That's a good idea. So the decree that is issued, and this is fascinating, the decree that's issued says nothing about Vashti being banished from the palace. It says nothing about her divorce from the king. The edict that comes from the king says that all women must obey their husbands. That's what it says. Interesting, isn't that? For a woman who has the courage to defy ungodly expectations. Because she realizes that fashion and being popular is a poor price to pay for the loss of one's dignity and integrity. Christian ideals might be considered old-fashioned. And indeed, we hear that in our society today, don't we? Well, that's old-fashioned. That's out of touch with modern society. It's in conflict with the trends of our times. Listen to this. God's favor rests upon those who have the courage to be ridiculed for such high godly ideals. That's where God's pleasure rests. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, there's some instructions there for wives and their husbands and how they live together with their husbands and how they adorn themselves for their husbands. And Peter is telling us we ought not to adorn ourselves for the onlooking world, because precious in the sight of God is our utmost goal. To be precious in the sight of God. And so we need to have courage to defy these ungodly expectations. Well, let's talk about Esther for a while. I couldn't help but observe Vashti and all that she has accomplished. But Esther shows us that we have courage to speak boldly in the face of opposition. Esther is a woman of courage, and she knew that what she was about to do may cost her life. And she says, if I perish, I perish. Because she realizes how important relief and deliverance is. Confronting what is not right involves risk, doesn't it? Usually, because there's going to be a confrontation there. There might be an argument. Listen, Paul had to do that. Paul had to confront the Apostle Peter. Galatians chapter 2 explains how Paul confronted him to his face and told him how he stood condemned. It's not easy to tell a person that you stand condemned. But that's what we need to have the courage to do, if in fact they stand condemned. What I think is interesting is that Mordecai says relief and deliverance will come from some other place if you choose not to act. But you've got a chance to be engaged in the work of God. And Esther says, I want to serve God. I want to be involved. I want to be engaged. Mordecai had already spoken about the coup that was taking place between Bigthan and Teresh. I mean, these are some great names that are in this book. Chapter 2, 21 to 23. Bigthan and Teresh, they're going to overthrow the king. I mean, they're going to kill him. And Mordecai sends word and says, you better be on the lookout for these two guys. And so they find the plot to be true. But yet Mordecai is never really honored for that. And he sits in the king's gate every day. And there's a guy that doesn't like it. His name is Haman. Haman had the king issue a decree that everyone should bow to him when he walks by. And so he would walk by the king's gate, and everybody who's gathered around the gate, everybody would bow down. They would pay homage to Haman, who was given the highest position in the land next to the king. And as everybody bowed down, Mordecai stood tall. Oh, what a great picture. Can you see that? Can you see the crowd that is gathered around the king's palace? Haman walks by, and everybody bows down, and there's one man left standing. Can you picture that? I mean, you talk about standing out in a crowd. That's Mordecai. He stands out in this crowd because he refuses to bow down and pay homage. And when he's challenged on that, he says, well, I bow to Jehovah. That's my God. I don't bow to anybody else. That takes great courage, doesn't it? Well, Haman doesn't like it. And so Haman asks what should be done. And so he is counseled into building this grand gallows where Mordecai can be hung. Well, word gets back, and Haman comes to the king. The king summons Haman to come in, and he realizes that nothing has been done for Mordecai in defending him from Bigthan and Teresh. And so he asks his people, what should we do for him? And they said we should honor him. And so he calls Haman in. And Haman is thinking, you know, in his own pride, read about Haman here. Because Haman is a man who lives in his own pride. And you know what they say comes after pride? A great fall. Well, Haman is boasting in his great pride and all of his position and his power and his wealth and everything that he has. And so the king is calling him in, and he thinks the king is going to honor him. And he says, what do we do for a man who honors the king? Throughout the story, Mordecai is the one to be honored. And Haman is the one to honor Mordecai. Oh, it's a great twist of affairs. And the gallows that were built would be for Haman and not Mordecai. Haman's devious plot was to annihilate all of the Jews. He was the Hitler of the 5th century BC. And they were going to be annihilated. Every last one of them killed. And the edict was published. It was written, and it was put out all over town and all of the 127 provinces that were governed by Ahasuerus. And this was made public. And there was a specific day that this would happen. And so Mordecai involves Esther to go and speak boldly to the king in the face of opposition. You better tell the king who you are. And you better tell them of Haman's plot. Sometimes you have to speak to people and give them clearer instruction when they believe something that is not true. And that's what Esther needed to explain to Ahasuerus, the king. That you have believed something that is not quite right. You know, there are people who believe things that the Bible doesn't say. Are you aware of that? There are people who don't believe things that the Bible does say. And I'm wondering who will have the courage to speak boldly despite the opposition. Who will bring relief and deliverance to people who need to hear the truth spoken in love? People's souls hang in the balance. That's how serious this is with Esther. People's lives hang in the balance. Mordecai says, look, if you be silent, relief and deliverance will come from some other place. Mordecai has an incredible faith in God to bring relief and deliverance, regardless of who's involved. But Mordecai knows that Esther is in a place where she can make a difference. Esther is in the right place at the right time. And he says, who knows that God has put you there so that you can be involved in his mission? If you only have the courage to speak boldly in the face of opposition. And if you have the courage to place the outcome in the hands of God. You see, that's the statement, if I perish, I perish. Esther says, okay, God, this is in your hands. She calls on the people to fast for her for 3 days and three nights. She says, I and my girls will do the same thing. We'll be fasting for 3 days and three nights. They're going to be pleading with God that he would bring the relief and the deliverance. I'll bet she's praying specifically that when I go into the king, God, please reach out his scepter from his hand. And he does. You see, the king is so pleased with Esther. And Esther comes in, and so she says, you know what? Anyone who goes into the king unannounced or uninvited will be put to death unless he extends that golden scepter. So a lot of people think, well, you know what? You're leaving it up to chance. Well, I hope you have a lucky day. And she says, oh no, luck is not involved. It has nothing to do with chance. It's in the hands of God. If I perish, I perish. God will bring relief and deliverance for my people. You see, deliverance is not dependent upon Esther's involvement. Esther has the opportunity to be engaged in what God is doing. Esther has the opportunity to be engaged in the ministry, the mission of relief and deliverance, as do we. Her courage comes from her prayer and her fasting, her dependence upon God. Depending on God for the outcome can never be wrong. Same is true with us. Same is true with us. If I perish, I perish. If this relationship is severed, it's severed. If my friends turn on me, they turn on me. But I'll not display myself in such a way that only my spouse should see me. I'll speak boldly for God and for relief and for deliverance. I'll speak boldly the truth that needs to be spoken. And I'll confront error when there's error. I'll speak out when people believe things that the Bible doesn't say, and when they when they don't believe things that the Bible does say. I'm going to speak out, and I'm going to let God's word do the talking. And if I perish, I perish. But people need to know this God. That's why we have this treasure in jars of clay, so that people might know that the power belongs to God, not to us. Paul didn't go to people in cleverness of speech. He went to them with the power of the gospel, the power of the word of God. That's what we need to do. And we need to place the outcome in God's hands. Listen, God uses his word a whole lot better than I do. Doesn't he use it a whole lot better than you do? Because it's his word. And he has said that his word would not return to him void. His word has great power, Hebrews chapter 4, in verse 12. It's living and it's active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It has the ability to divide soul and spirit, bone and marrow. This book has the ability to judge the thoughts and the attitudes of our hearts. This word has power. Paul would explain to Timothy that the word of God is breathed out by God, and that it is useful for teaching and rebuking and correcting and training in righteousness, so that the person of God can be adequate, thoroughly equipped for every good work, so that they can be equipped to be engaged in the mission of God, that R&D department of God, relief and deliverance from God. When you and I seize the opportunity of being in the right place at the right time, God always does the right thing. You believe that? Are you in the right place at the right time? Esther was simply a jar of clay. That's all she was. But she had a treasure within herself. It was relief and deliverance. It was obedience. It was faithfulness. She had this treasure, this knowledge of God's power in that jar of clay. And she let it loose because she was a woman of God's courage. And we can be too when we have the courage to engage together in his mission of relief and deliverance. Well, I believe we can do great things. Maybe I'll check that statement. I believe God can do great things when we're engaged in his mission. Do you believe that? Are you in the right place at the right time right now in somebody's life to bring relief and deliverance to somebody's life, to somebody's family? Do you know somebody that needs you to have the courage to speak up, to explain to them things the Bible says and things that the Bible doesn't say? Is somebody waiting on you to demonstrate that courage to speak up in the face of opposition and to proclaim the righteousness of God? Or are you in the right place at the right time to be the one who receives relief and deliverance? Who knows but that you have been in this place today to know the gospel of God and to find that relief and deliverance from God himself. To know that you can be delivered from sin. To know that you can experience and appreciate the righteousness of God. To know that you can come to God so that you can know the power of God. Do you need to know that? Do you need to understand some things that the Bible says and really know things that the Bible doesn't say? I'd love the chance to study with you and answer questions that you have. Just let me know, and we'll spend time together. We'll sit down, we'll open the Bible together, and we'll hear what God has to say. Would you have the courage to know that you're in the right place at the right time? Let's stand together and let's sing. Yeah.